I was toting my pack along the dusty Winnemucca road, when along came a semi with a high-end canvas-covered load. If you're going to Winnemucca, Mac, with me you can ride. And so I climbed into the cab and then I settled down inside. He asked me if I'd seen a road with so much dust and sand, and I said, listen, I've traveled every road in this here land. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts bare, man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Of travel I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere.
Hi, everybody. This is Dr. Ed Parker. We're doing podcast number 8 on vision and macular degeneration. And today we're joined by special guest Don Biondich. I just want to review the normal eye anatomy real quick. So basically, this is what an eyeball is. You got the lens, you got the aperture, which is kind of like the tabletop in this weird table, and that lets the pupil get bigger and smaller because it lets in more or less light. And so it's focused on the back wall of the globe, and it's an area called the macula, where they have a bunch of little rods and cones here to detect the images. Rods are for nighttime or dim light. Cones are for more of the bright light, and actually they just discovered a few years ago a third type of photoreceptor ganglion cells up here. Anyway, so vision is optics, it's lens focusing an image, and it's also cognitive, it's also the occipital lobe here processing these images. Second slide is an optics review. Basically, if this is a normal focal length and you flatten out the lens, it'll go farther back to focus the image, and if it's more round and refractive, it'll go closer up, just like if you have a camera lens focusing closer far. Myopia is when the image focuses too soon, so you could think of it as like a football-shaped eye, and then obviously use the lens to correct that. Presbyopia, or farsightedness, it's not really that you can see far, it's just that you can't see close, so these old terms are kind of unhelpful. But presbyopia, meaning old person's vision, is a failed accommodation. So what is accommodation? Accommodation is when you take the lens and you release these strings. There's a circular muscle surrounding the lens, and when it contracts, the circle gets smaller, and like a gummy bear that's not stale, it'll get rounder and more refractive. So as your lens gets older, it becomes less like a gummy bear and more just like a stale candy. So that therein lies the problem. Accommodation, meaning like a macro lens focusing close up, declines with age, probably as a function of the stiffness of the lens. Basically, it's measured in diopters, and you can see when you're a little young kid, you can see right up close to your eyes. As you get older, 25 is the magic number when everything starts to go literally downhill. And by the time you're in your 40s or 50s, you're having to hold things at arm's length, and that is presbyopia. So today we like to focus on age-related macular degeneration. They usually call it age-related. There is no really other kind of macular degeneration. There is the juvenile Stargardt's disease, but it doesn't need to concern you. But there are a lot of ways the fovea, or the central part of the retina, the image processing part, can go bad. But basically what happens is the optometrist looks in, they see these deposits called drusen, which are various just deposits of metals and complement and glycoproteins. It's burnt out. They're like bulbs. You know, your eyes work great. They work for a long time, but they're not designed to go the full 150 or whatever it is we're heading to now. Here's a graph that I found on age-related macular degeneration, and this is just contrasting African Americans versus Caucasians. The important point is everybody's going to get it, and it's just like if you drove 67 Mercedes, you know, eventually everyone would replace the parts or the light bulbs. At 66 to 74, 10% people have findings consistent, and it just increases. A slide I like to use is what's called replicative senescence. So we know that mechanically copying the DNA always shortens its 1,500 base pairs. Stem cells use telomerase to counteract that. Short telomeres cause mutations, and that's covered in podcast 2, how that works. Non-stem cells can and should die off, otherwise we would grow into these humongous unsustainable blobs within hours. So the stem cells are like queen bees. If you put any cell in a dish and let it copy, it'll only divide about 50 or 60 times, the so-called Hayflick limit, before the number of chromosomal aberrations caused by shortening of its telomeres renders that colony dead. Here is a paper I found from 1999, which perfectly illustrates the Hayflick limit replicative senescence in eye cells in a dish. What they showed was that the RPE, the retinal pigment epithelium, meaning the stuff that makes the eye, if they passaged it, meaning they let the colony divide over and over again until 80% of the cells were no longer dividing, again, that's shown in this chart, what they found was that at 58 doublings or 58 divisions, only 20% of the cells were still dividing, meaning they labeled for this marker of division. They were not alive. They might have been alive, but they weren't dividing, which is critical. Whereas 57% were senescent, and that's shown by the presence of this chemical. As we would expect, that mean telomere length was also reduced from the birth endowment that we all get of 10,000 back even when you're only 12 divisions in, say in a human life as a child. By the time you got to 58 divisions, you only had 4,000 left, and that's the disease that we get in all our organs. That is aging. This is a slide that we've used before. It's called mesenchymal stem cells equals traveling queen bees for hire. And the central concept here is that there's one disease. It's the aging of these queen bees. Of course, the drones can only be as good as she is, meaning they inherit her telomere length, her age, and her quality, meaning the genetic integrity and the epigenetic signals. So you got these mesenchymal stem cells whose job it is to find out where the action is, where the destruction, where the inflammation is. They go there, and they'll replace neurons, fat cells, cartilage, bone. Last two podcasts were 7 and 6, respectively, were on cartilage and bone disease. All your muscles, your liver cells, pancreas cells. So if you take chemo and nuke your queen bees, something's going to come in and replace it. And guess what? All the drones will hopefully inherit a better copy. So how does this work? Well, in the eye, we know that the mesenchymal stem cell, you can actually make them. You take a human adipose-derived mesenchymal stromal cell, and you can differentiate just by being in that environment. So mesenchymal stem cells, they don't necessarily know what they're doing, but when they get to a certain tissue, whether it be the heart or the liver, the local existing neighborhood tells them via chemical signaling how to differentiate to be helpful to that community. It was 3 weeks ago, we talked to the world's expert in stem cell biology, Dr. Mike West, and he brought up a concept called senestatic activation, which definitely resonated when I found this article. It says that in the case of wet macular degeneration, this metalloproteinase, collagenase, basically it's an enzyme that destroys collagen, contributes to that wet macular degeneration. And they found that if you, it's the mesenchymal stem cells that are mediating this. And basically, I think that the problem with that theory is that they're putting the cart before the horse. In this case, my opinion, which is just what it is, just a crazy guess by a layperson, but I think they're putting the cart before the horse because the inflammation, the drusen, and which we said was made up of zinc proteins, that should make you think of metalloproteinases, complement cascade, which is intrinsic inflammation mechanism. Again, Dr. West said that when cells burn out or they get old, they are in a sense static or inflammatory state. All these things, neovascularization, which is typically the wet macular degeneration, it's just a different response to burned out stem cell niches saying, hey, we need more help here. So the mesenchymal stem cell is not the problem. That's just the bystander that comes afterwards and gets accused of the crime. And likewise, the metalloproteinases, they're all there to put out the fire. So the smoke doesn't cause the fire. The fire at the heart of all these diseases that we talk about with aging, arthritis, Alzheimer's, which he called, you know, arthritis of the brain, it's the telomere damage, which is perfectly natural. The P55 or 53 signaling, which triggers mitochondrial dysfunction and sometimes purposefully to cause apoptosis or cell death. Sensec activation, which you should go to podcast 5 and review that if you'd like. And senescence apoptosis, which is not a bad thing. It's part of the way that the body clears the bad stuff. And I think that's really what 65 is doing as a mechanism. It's killing off some of the ones that couldn't be killed off, and then hopefully somebody comes in and repopulates it with a new mesenchymal stem cell. And that's the mechanism, I think, why Rocky's back got straighter and why Jerry's arthritis improved. It's just you're getting rid of those crotchety ones that are just phoning it in. I had a patient who was featured on CBS News, and this just showed 15 months of change. And what's interesting, we do a contrast sensitivity, and you're supposed to, each one gets harder as you go across the rows, and they're just bars in different frequencies. So before TA65, he was a 6 and a 6. On this second row, he was a 5 and a 4. So that went, after 15 months, up to the 8 and a 7, which is a pretty remarkable improvement. In the last row, he went from a 2 and a 3 over to a 6 and a 6, which is unusual in a 66-year-old gentleman.
But Simpson and his wife, Perry, have really noticed measured results in improved vision.
The vision I noticed, especially watching television, I will be watching, especially now with high def, you can really zero in and you see that detail.
Simpson's doctor, Edward Park, has been monitoring his vision, heart, lungs, and skin since starting on TA65 18 months ago.
Not only did his reading vision improve, but his myopia improved. The people are throwing away reading glasses, blood pressure is coming down. Larry's lung capacity went up a liter, which is like a 20-year jump.
Don saw that, and he got interested. So he wrote me a letter after he started. You know, he was skeptical at first, but when you're desperate, I guess you're willing to try things, and he's a very open-minded, free-spirited guy. So he wrote me this letter, which I'll quickly run through. It said, within the last year, this is Don writing to me, and a half, my eyesight started to diminish. All the ophthalmologists that I consulted said that I would go blind, and my eyesight is slowly going to get worse, so much so that in a couple of years I'll not be able to drive a car. Then I saw your TV interview about TA65 and other news releases on the product, and I was intrigued about the positive results with eye problems. I'm taking 4 capsules nightly, and I've been doing this for over a month, and I have definite measured results that are positive. Because of my macular degeneration, I've been using a grid chart to make sure that the dry generation doesn't turn wet, which is serious. And since I've been using TA65, the area of the grid that used to be distorted is now diminished. I like to play solitaire on the computer. Before the treatment, I had some difficulty distinguishing the 8 and 9. Now I can make this distinction. Also, my vision for distance is improving. The reason I can judge this is that I was experiencing diminished sight. I would practice looking at objects around me, and now those objects are getting clearer and brighter. So as is the case with all these webinars, it's people who want to share their results who just have experienced what they would consider a miracle. Let's get Don on the call now. I'm going to unmute you. Don, are you there?
Hello.
Hi, Don.
Yes, sir.
Perfect, yeah.
Okay, great.
So, Were you able to hear that? Was my voice too soft?
Yes, I was, and I watched it on the fuse deal, and it, yeah. It's very interesting, and what you said there is actually happening to me. My vision is improving.
Awesome. So this is kind of something I threw together. Dawn was telling me last night that, well, I guess your vision is similar to this. On the outside, you can see fine, but towards the middle where you would recognize faces, it's not quite this bad, but is it something?
It was that way, and if you take the picture on the left there, if I looked at it with my left eye shut, the degeneration's in my right eye.
Only on the right, yeah.
The soccer, and I could see the boy to the right, but if I was looking at the boy to the left, it would be blurred like in the picture to the right.
Mm. But the acuity in the periphery is okay, though.
Yes.
Around the central area, okay.
Yeah.
And the grids below, the one on the left, that's a little worse than your previous.
Yes, that's about twice as distorted as what I had. But if you look at the right now, I can almost see that completely now without any distortion. And that's where the realization that this stuff is really working.
That's amazing. Yeah, because when you had written that letter to me, that was, what, a month and a half, 2 months ago?
At least, yeah.
At least, right? So it's been, what, how many months are you on now?
Let's see, 2040, 90. I've been on it almost 3 months.
Yeah, so it's been progressive improvement.
Yeah, it was amazing. I understand that, when you're replacing cells and that, it takes a while, so you have to be patient and let the drugs work. But it was fairly immediate to me, so that's why I contacted you.
And that's consistent with what, let's say, Rocky's scoliosis. It was great at 6 months, but it got even better at 10 months. And that's what people describe. It just gets better. It gets better with age, like wine and like people who want to kid themselves if they're still attracted to young people.
That's
as you take more of this. Well, you're like the Dos Equis guy. You're the most interesting man in the world.
Yeah, right.
Well,
that and an apple gets you a cup of coffee.
Have you seen that commercial? Stay thirsty, my
friend.
Yes,
I have.
Yeah.
I get a kick out of it.
Well, let's see here. Is this kind of similar to the solitaire that you play?
Yes. It's a standard solitaire program in the computer, from the PC and or as I have a Mac that they have in it.
Yeah.
And
so back in the last fall, the 5 and the 6 look kind of similar to you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the 5 and the 6 and the 8
and
the 9s. I had trouble distinguishing them. I had to really strain my eyesight and look to the left, to the right to kind of bring it in focus. And now I can look at it directly, and I can see the difference.
Amazing.
Yeah, and the cards are small on my computer. I can't enlarge them any. And so that is really amazing to me.
Yeah, I mean, right about now, everyone's bullshit sensor is going off. But, basically, this is the deal, right? I mean.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Without a doubt, this stuff is working. And, of course, I also take bilberry, and I also take Ocuvite, an antioxidant, which was recommended to me by the ophthalmologist to stave off wet macular degeneration, I guess.
It's funny that you mention that because it's an antioxidant, and when you look through the Cochrane trials, which I always try and do, which it's these people who try and cast judgment on the existing medical literature, they said that there's really nothing that treats macular degeneration except one large trial with Ocuvite. But, of course, that was sponsored by the Bausch & Lomb company who makes it. So they raised questions as to whether that was really good. But, I mean, they're selling a lot of it. Whether it works, who knows?
Yeah, well, let's face it. I've been taking Ocuvite for a couple of years now, and it has not turned wet. So whether that's a result of the Ocuvites or not. But I know I do this. I buy them at Costco because they're a lot cheaper.
Yeah. Well, in January of this year, the FDA approved an embryonic stem cell-derived treatment for macular degeneration, so that's going to be ongoing. And then Dr. West, featured in Podcast 5, talked about products that they're trying to bring to market for retinal progenitor cells. But yeah, I think the best way is to go with self-derived, obviously, but then also if you can fix what's there or replace it with your own good stuff, probably that's a good stem cell therapy too.
Yeah, I agree 100%. It's working.
Well, that's cool. So anyway, you were kind enough to let me see your other medical records, which was impressive to me. I didn't realize how much there was to mine there. Do you mind if we talk about that a little bit?
Not at all.
Okay. So I just entitled this the Septuagenarian Blues, which shows your curve here. How many people are alive at birth versus, I mean, you could draw this number here at 70, 72, let's say. So if you cure one disease, you might get another one. So what you do with TA65, hopefully, or any telomerase activation, is you're shifting the curve to the right, so everything's staying healthier for longer. That's indicated by this different curve. But no matter what it is, as you get older, you start to acquire all the diseases because the traditional way of thinking, I believe, is incorrect. They think of diseases as something that are genetically endowed or, you know, sporadic, but in actuality, they're like merit badges. You collect each one as you go along. And they're like car parts that will burn out. And if you drive a car for 1,000,000 miles, guess what? You're going to replace everything. So I like to think of Gilda Radner's line, if it's not one thing, it's another. And that's what we're talking about. So, Don, you're 76, and you got what everyone collects, which is prostate cancer. How's that?
That was taken care of. They used brachytherapy to. I chose that method of treatment. So, and I've been, that was several years ago, and I'm free of it now.
So the supraventricular tachycardia, the fluttering of the heart, that's not a big problem for you anymore?
No, they control that. And I just I haven't had an episode in, gosh, I can't remember how long. They're controlling it with medication.
So good. So you have the hypertension, which everyone collects. That's another merit badge.
Yeah.
The thickening of the arteries. And you had a closed fracture. Is this when you laid down your gold wing, or what happened here? You got a bone fracture?
Oh, yeah. When I laid my Harley down, I fractured my rib.
Very nice. We were riding a Harley at age, what, 68?
Oh, I was riding it up to 2 years ago, or 2 year ago, actually.
Oy, okay. Well, we'll have to talk about that judgment. We'll have to get your wife, Judy, on the line. She'll have to tell us what's wrong with you. She probably knows after being married to you for 51 years, right?
Yeah, 51 years, and she still hasn't figured out what's wrong with me.
Oh, really? I mean, it only took my wife 18, so she's here's avascular necrosis. So they tried to replace your hip, and you got avascular necrosis, which just means the blood supply didn't take. So what's the status on that?
Oh, the hip's great. I had the original hip done 15 years ago, I guess, right when it had arthritis in it. And they just did the head of the femur. And they said that would last about 10 years, and they put a cup in, and that would last longer rather than do the head and the cup at that time. And sure enough, about 10 years, I had the cup put in, and that was 5 or 6 years ago, and I could still swing my leg over a motorcycle, so.
Excellent. That's good stuff.
Yeah.
So you had coronary artery disease. Were you having angina and stuff like that?
No. I really don't know. I've never had any heart pain. I've never had a heart attack, fortunately.
They went ahead and they put a little metal tube to keep that left anterior descending artery open.
They put a stent in there, right. Yeah. That's right. I forgot about that.
So you had smoked for a while up until a few years ago, and probably as a result you got COPD, although COPD also happens just from burning out of the lung stem cells, I think. But that's been a challenge for you as well. Actually, you were supposed to do my webinar a month ago, and you were so rude. You got the flu and pneumonia.
Yeah, pneumonia in my right lung.
Yeah, it's terrible. So I saw that you'd been vaccinated for pneumococcus, which prevents one of the common pneumonias, and also for the flu in the fall, yet you still got the flu, huh?
Yeah. I don't know what happened there. It's probably a strain that wasn't covered, but I did get that. But the COPD is not a problem with me unless I get a cold or something, get congestion in my chest. Otherwise, I don't even hardly use any inhalers.
Well, that's good. So In terms of lung function, we're seeing a lot of improvement in some of the patients. Larry had a 1.2 improvement, so that tells me that the plasticity and the stem cell quality is improving. So, you know, flu at 76 years old is no joke. That could have a high rate of killing people. How did you do with that?
Great. I went in the hospital, and they gave me antibiotics for 2 days and let me go, and I was fine.
Wow, fabulous.
Yeah, I do feel that since I have been taking the TA-65, that my I can move and function like I used to a few years ago. It wasn't that I could always stand up without using assistance. Now I can just stand up like I did when I was in grade school, you know, and that's an improvement there.
Just the vitality is there. Just there's just more energy.
Yeah, that's it. And, you know, and I need that because we travel quite a bit. So it's good to standing in lines at airports and flying long distances and everything and getting out and enjoying yourself.
Oh, yeah. So you're going to, let's see here. I put some little pictures here that you might like.
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
You're going to go see the mountain gorillas in June, right?
Gorillas, that's what we're going to go see in Rwanda in June. And I flew both those aircraft atop. The one in the float planes I flew out of Alaska. That picture of my motorcycle, that's the Rockies. And right across those hills there is aspen, to get an idea where it is.
That's beautiful. That looks like the spring.
Yeah. Well, no, it was fall. I was just on that. It was October, and I was just traveling ahead of the snowstorms that were chasing me home.
Well, here's the Masai Maru here, where you've been a couple times, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's your De Havilland beaver, which you flew in Alaska, not in California though.
Yeah, I flew them here, but not with floats.
Yeah.
I flew them here when they had whales.
And this is the F-86 from the Korean War era.
Yep.
That looks like a real safe thing to fly, basically a man on a jet engine.
It's a hot rod.
Well, do you know this song by Johnny Cash?
Yes, I do.
Kind of made me think of that at 4 o'clock this morning. So hopefully you'll be going some other places now that you're feeling a little better.
Oh, yeah, we've got trips planned, 4 more trips after our Africa trip this year.
Okay, where are you going?
We're going to Portugal and Spain, and then we're going to go over to Switzerland and Luxembourg, and then we're going to, I can't remember the other one. But I'm sorry. You caught me at a senior moment.
It's okay. You're forgiven. Yeah. So you've been on all 7 continents. You even stepped on Antarctica, right?
Yep. That was a great trip.
So, it's good stuff. I mean, you get a real buzz from traveling, I guess.
Yeah, and my wife enjoys it. She's a graduate anthropologist, and so she has a lot of interest in the places we go. We go to a lot of out-of-way places. We've been up the Amazon several times, and been to all the Aztec, Inca, and ruins in South and Central America, and, of course, Egypt, the Egyptology thing, which is my favorite.
Oh, yeah, I can't wait to see the Valley of the Kings. So she's she's the Indiana Jones. You're just the tag-along, huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, exactly. You know, she sets the pace, and I follow.
That's great. It's pretty amazing how much traveling you've done. Hey, I wanted to ask you about some of these other just points. So you had the bad stomach ulcer with the pyloric stenosis, and for people that don't know what that means, the exit valve is kind of tight, so they dilated that with a balloon a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
As a result, you had the macrocytic anemia because the stomach makes this thing called intrinsic factor to absorb B12. How's your ulcer now? Have you noticed any difference?
No, it's under control now. I got a great gastroenterologist. And
probably just opening the valve helped a lot.
Yes, and he did that 2 or 3 times, actually, over a period of maybe a year and a half. And that's a couple of years ago, and haven't needed it since. So, and you know, we eat a lot of foods all over the world and things, and my stomach is fine, fortunately.
Oh yeah, it's crazy when you travel. And have you had your cholesterol checked? Is it the same, or do you not know?
It was just checked. I don't know if you had the latest one, and my cholesterol is fine. My triglycerides are a little high, and
well,
so they increase my omega-3 and things, too, and they're going to try another blood test in 2 months to see how that's working.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see. I think it does help with the apolipoproteins. My cholesterol dropped to normal, but losing 30 pounds will do that. And my fatty liver cleared. And how's the sleep? Because insomnia was noted in your record.
Yeah, it's better now. I didn't have a real severe insomnia, but I used you know, with some sleep medicine, whatever you call it, once in a while to if I'm kind of restless. But here lately, it seems like I've been doing okay without it.
All right. Well, that's cool. So how would you sum up your experience overall? Have you noticed any other things that we haven't discussed, or would you recommend it to other folks?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Definitely recommend it. And the experience been, of course, a dramatic improvement in my macular degeneration, and also just my overall health and moving around. I got a lot more spring to my step, I think. So, I mean, those are the noticeable factors. And the other one is concrete with the macular degeneration, because I'm looking at my chart right now, and where I used to have a blur in that area where the, you know, where the center dot is, it's hardly any distortion at all.
That's amazing. Yeah, I saw the doctor's notes, and she said that you went from 2.25 diopters on your reading glasses on your to 1.25, so that got weaker, which is very consistent with other patients.
Yeah.
I mean, the lens is softer then.
Yeah. So, and I have an appointment with her to see her in June after we get back from Africa to check them again to see what the measured, you know, results are from this last test just last month till then.
Yeah, well, that'll be good. I mean, it's like it's softening, so that's good. Have your arteries softened? How's your blood pressure?
Blood pressure is fine. We're controlling it with, I guess, lovastatin and a couple of things. But I'm hanging in there around 140 to 70, 75, 130 to 65, you know, depending. But it's in that range.
Good. How's your skin, hair, and nails? Have you noticed any difference?
Well, my hair is gone. I still got my skin and nails, and they're doing fine. My nails grow like mad.
Yeah, I noticed that too, and most people do say that. Because those are telomerase active cells, even though they're not truly stem-like. And the skin quality, is that pretty much the same? Or?
Yeah, that hasn't changed. I haven't noticed that much difference anyway.
All right. Well, this is great. So I'm going to open up to calls. Do you want to take some calls, perhaps?
Sure.
All right, let's see that. Any questions? I think they're all just mesmerized by your lust for life.
Probably bored to death.
Maybe that too. All right, I'm kind of delirious from being up till 4, so if nobody has a question, I'm just going to hang it up.
Okay.
Yeah, anything else that you want to add?
No, I just, I'm going to continue with the treatment and what's not to do as far as my experience goes, and just hope for the best, and I think it'll come about.
I think so. Is Judy available? Can we talk to her?
She's shopping.
Oh, okay. Quality time. I think it was, you know, interesting, and I really appreciate you suggesting the webinar and being so open about everything. It's really great. All right, sir, so you're still taking 4 a night, right?
Well, I take 4 a day.
Okay, good. You don't take a night time?
I take breakfast, lunch, dinner, and night time.
Okay. Well, it seems to be working. All right, senor. I think we're done. Okay, Don. Hey, have a great day.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for participating. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure. Thank you very again. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye.
I've been to Reno, Chicago, Fargo, Minnesota, Buffalo, Toronto, Winslow, Sarasota, Wichita, Tulsa, Ottawa, Oklahoma, Tampa, Panama, Mattawa, La Paloma, Bangor, Baltimore, Salvador, Amarillo, Tocopilla, Barranquilla, and Padilla. I'm a killer. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare man. I breathe the mountain air, man. Travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere. I've been to Boston, Charleston, Dayton, Louisiana, Washington, Houston, Kingston, Texarkana, Monterey, Faraday, Santa Fe, Tallapoosa, Glen Glenrock, Black Rock, Little Rock, Oskaloosa, Tennessee, Tennessee, Chicopee, Spirit Lake, Grand Lake, Devil's Lake, Crater Lake, the Beach Lake. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere.